Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In this video, I'm going to tell you about a third important property about Poisson processes. This property is called the conditioning property, and it says the following. So assume that XT is a right new Poisson process. You define tau I to be the ith jump, the time of the ith jump of the process. Then assuming or given the event that there are exactly n jumps by time t, then the position of those jumps in time are going to be distributed according to n independent uniform random variable in the interval 0 t. Equivalently, you can think of the problem in terms of Poisson point process in one dimension. If you have a Poisson point process in one dimension with intensity mu, and you look at the interval 0 t, you look at the points in the interval 0 t, we know that the number of points is random and it's Poisson distributed with parameter mu times t. But given the event that there are exactly n points in this interval 0 t, then the position of those points is described by this collection of n independent uniform random variables. So you have to be careful. If you look carefully at the slide, this equation tau 1, tau 2 up to tau n is equal to u1, u2 up to un is obviously not true almost surely. That's true in distribution. And you have to also have in mind that we are looking at two sets and not two vectors, because indeed, by definition of the tau I, tau 1 is the leftmost point to the right of zero. The tau 2 is the position of the second leftmost point, and so on. So that means that tau 1 is less than tau 2, which is less than tau 3, and so on. While if you take n independent uniform random variable in the interval 0 t, there is no reason that u1 is less than u2, and so on. So this equation is only an equation in distribution, and that's an equation for two sets of n points and not two vectors. So let's prove this result. So here I have a picture of the time at which the Poisson process is going to jump. You can again think about that as points, Poisson points in a Poisson point process in one dimension. The intensity is equal to mu. I remind you that those random variables ui are uniformly distributed in the interval 0 t. So the first step, we don't have any specific order for those ui, it's going to be to order them. So you have n factorial possible ordering of those uniform random variables. I'm going to call vi the ith smallest of those random variables. So v1 is going to be the smallest uniform, v2 is the second smallest, and so on. So let's call vi the ith smallest among the uniform random variable. And so then in this case, we no longer have an equation in terms of sets, in an equation in distribution in terms of sets, but we have really that in distribution, we expect that V1 is equal to tau 1, V2 is equal to tau 2, V3 is equal to tau 3, and so on. Again, be careful in distribution. And so the goal is to prove that V1, V2 up to Vn, so the ordering of those n uniform random variables that are independent, is equal in distribution. I'm going to put a little d here to say in distribution, should be equal to this vector tau 1, tau 2, and so on up to tau n. So we want to prove that. That's a little bit more tricky than that. That's not equal in distribution. That's also equal in distribution, but given that indeed we have n points here. In my picture, n equals 4. You see tau 4 is after time t. No, tau 4 is before time t, but tau 5 is after time t. So we want to prove that the conditional density function of this vector, given that xt is equal to n, is going to be indeed equal to the density function of this vector here. So first, let's look at the density function of this vector. I'm going to call it g, for instance. So we have something g of s1 up to sn. That's going to be the density function of this vector of vi, so v1 up to vn. So how can we compute this density function? Well, the idea is just to see that first, the probability that this vector is equal to the same vector for the ui is equal to, so that's going to be 1 over n factorial. That's due to the fact that there are n factorial possible orderings of those uniform random variables, and all n factorial possible orderings are equally likely. So to compute this density function, the first step is to see that the probability that v1, v2 up to vn is equal to u1, u2 up to un. Now be careful, I don't have sets. Of course, the set of the set v1, v2 up to vn is by definition equal to the set u1, u2 up to un. Now I'm not looking at the set anymore, I'm looking at vectors. So we are looking exactly at the probability that v1 is equal to u1 and v2 is equal to u2 and so on. So that means exactly that we look at the probability that u1 is less than u2, which itself is less than u3 and so on. So because all the possible orderings of those n uniform random variables are equally likely, and because there are n factorial possible ordering, the probability of those two vectors being equal is just equal to 1 divided by n factorial. So from that you can deduce the density function here. The density function g of s1 up to sn is going to be equal to, so that's going to be, because of this n factorial, that's going to be equal to exactly n factorial, so we have n factorial possible ordering, times, so n factorial, times the density function of u1 at point s1, times the density function of u2 at point s2, and so on. So eventually I have a product. The reason why I can indeed write this as a product, now we are looking at the density function of this. So the reason why we indeed have a product is because we assume that those random variables ui are independent. And clearly the probability, or not the probability, but I should say the density function of ui is equal to 1 over t. That's the length of this interval. That's exactly the expression of the density function of those ui. It's the density function is equal to 1 over t for like in the interval 0 t and 0 outside. So this tells you that eventually you get this times 1 over t. So, but this at the power n, because you have n such random variables, so eventually that's the density function of of this vector v1, v2 up to vn. So now we have this result, I'm going to erase this to have more space. So maybe we can also, so we are not going to use that anymore, so let's just write quickly that the density function of this set of random variables that are not ordered, that's those UIs, but order from the smallest one to the largest one, is equal to n factorial times 1 over t at the power n. So now next step is to look instead at the conditional density function of T1, T2, T3, and so on up to Tn, the conditional density given the event that xt is equal to n. So to do this, I'm going to look at this density. I'm going to call it h. We call that one g, so let's call it h. So now we need to look at h of, again, s1, s2, up to sn, but given that xt is equal to n. So now you see, to solve this problem, I'm going to, we don't really know like the distribution of those time, but we know that the distance between consecutive points are independent exponential on a variable with parameter mu. So that's what we are going to use here. I'm going to call this time increment here t1, and this second time increment here t2, and so on. And so not only we know the distribution of those times, but also we know that those time increments are independent. While at the opposite, clearly tau1, tau2, and so on are not independent. Clearly, tau2, for instance, cannot be smaller than tau1, so there is some kind of like interaction between those random variables tau i. So the idea is instead to look at those times. So now, looking at the density function, we are going to get exactly the fact that, so this conditional density function is going to be the density function of t1. So that's going to be exactly mu times e to the minus mu s1. That's the density function at point s1 of an exponential random variable with parameter mu. So we have this. Again, I'm expressing that as a product because those random variables are independent. Here, what I'm saying is that the density function of tau1, tau2, tau3, and so on is the product of the density functions of t1, t2, and so on. But now we want t1 to be equal to s1, but t2 is equal to this increment s2 minus s1. So eventually you multiply this by mu times e to the minus mu s2 minus s1, and so on. So that corresponds to the second term here. Then you go up to the last one. It's going to be mu e to the minus mu times sn minus sn minus 1 minus sn minus 1. Then you still need to multiply by the probability. So now we have a conditioning on xt equals n. So that means that my next time increment that's going to correspond to tn plus 1, so that's here, the tn plus 1 is here, it's going to be, needs to be larger than t minus sn. Sn is here, this little s here that represents this, so it's here, and so we need this time increment to be larger than this time interval here, the length of this time interval, which is t minus sn. So I still need to multiply that to look at the intersection of those two events by mu. So that's the probability. Sorry, that's the probability that the last one. So that's going to be we called it. So that's going to be t n plus 1. T n plus 1 must be larger than t minus sn. Okay? So that's by this probability that we need to multiply. So now you see that again this one is exponentially distributed with parameter mu, and so this probability here is exactly of the same form as before, but without the mu here. That's just going to be e to the minus mu times t minus sn. So I'm going to replace that right now. So here we have times e to the minus mu t minus Sn. So you see again that's product of the density functions of those independent exponential random variables, but we apply them at S1, S2 minus S1 and so on. This corresponds to the probability that the next point in the Poisson point process is indeed after time t. So this corresponds to some kind of density function of like intersection. So now we look at the intersection of with this event here. We still need to divide by the probability of that to have the conditional density function. So this is this divided by the probability that xt is equal to n. So now we are almost done. Remember what we want to do now, the last step is just to prove that this expression here on the right hand side is equal to this n factorial divide, n factorial times 1 over t at the power of n. And so this will show that indeed the conditional density function of tau 1, tau 2, up to tau n, given that x is equal to n, is indeed equal to this vector. Yeah. And so for that, we just look at this expression. You see that there are a lot of simplification. You have an e to the minus mu s1 here, but here you have an e at the power mu times s1. So this one disappears with the s1 here. You have the same that repeats with S2 here and so on, and then the Sn also disappears with the previous one. So we only keep both mu, so you have mu times mu n times, so you have a mu at the power n here. Then you see that this e to the minus mu Sn appears again here, but now it's e at the power mu Sn plus mu Sn. So this one is again going to disappear with that one. And so eventually this simplifies. And if you look at this expression, we end up with just mu at the power n. So this is equal to mu at the power n times, eventually we still have this e to the minus mu t, e to the minus mu t, and we still need to divide by the probability that xt is equal to n. So I'm going to write this here. So divided by the probability that xt is equal to n. So this divided by the probability that xt is equal to n. Then you just write the expression. I mean, what does it mean, this? Well, that means that a Poisson random variable, because xt is a Poisson process with write mu, that's like the probability that xt is equal to n is exactly the probability that a Poisson random variable with parameter mu times t is equal to n. So eventually we can write that, so this is mu at the power n e to the minus mu t divided by, so this is going to be the parameter mu t at the power n divided by n factorial. Here I'm writing exactly the probability that a Poisson random variable with parameter mu t is equal to n. So we start with that, then we still have this e to the minus mu t. You see again a lot of simplification here. This e to the minus mu t disappears with this one. You have a mu n here that disappears with that. And so eventually you get 1 divided by t at the power n over n factorial, and that's equal to this n factorial here times 1 over t at the power n. So 1 over t at the power n. Now you see that this the expression, the final expression of this conditional density function of those random variables tau 1, tau 2, tau 3 is given by that. That's exactly the same expression as the density function of those uniform random variable after they've been reordered. And so you recognize here the exact same expression. So indeed, this shows the conditioning properly.